tomorrow night. But this morning, I wanted to share with you about something that the Lord laid on my heart. And basically, it's some of the things that we have been talking about in church for years, things that we have perpetuated in church, things that we have taught and preached. And how many of you know just because you think you've heard something in church doesn't really make it true? Come on, you got to talk to me now. In other words, how many of you know just because it's like saying, oh, I saw it on the internet, it must be true. Come on now. We have been talking about things in church for many, many years, and over the years, I've heard things over and over that I just don't think are necessarily true. I've found them in my life not to be true, and so I wrote a message talking about certain lies, certain misconceptions in the body of Christ that I wanted to share with you today, because how many of you know just because you think you know something doesn't mean you really know it? And just because you think you've heard something doesn't mean you've really comprehended it. And so we're going to talk about today a few things that we've taught in church that aren't true. You say, well, I didn't grow up Assembly of God. I don't care if you grew up Catholic, Methodist, Baptist, Lutheran, Episcopalian. It doesn't matter. There are three things that we've taught in church that are simply not true. But before I get into that, let me tell you about a little bit about how I grew up. First of all, how many have never seen my ministry before today? Raise your hand nice and high. Wow, all these are new victims. This is going to be awesome. Well, I grew up in a Pentecostal church. I grew up in a very churchy environment, for lack of a better word. I've never known anything but church. My mom and dad have been preaching since they were 15 years old. I've grown up in a very rich heritage of ministry. My sister is a worship leader at a great church in Florida. And so I grew up in church. There was no other options. When it was time to go to church, I had to go to church. People come to me all the time and say, my kids won't come to church. I had to get my backside in church. There was no other option. My dad said, we're going to church. I'd say, well, I got homework. He'd say, well, you can do it when we get back from church. I'd say, well, I don't feel well. We'll lay hands on you at church. I could say, my arm fell off. We'll pray one grow back at church. Because you're going to church. There wasn't any option. And we didn't, now you got people in there taking care of your kids. We didn't have kids' church. We didn't have Bible, man. My God, we got vegetables telling kids about Jesus nowadays. I didn't have computer animated cucumbers telling me about the Holy Ghost and tomatoes telling me not to lie and broccoli telling me to honor my parents. We had the flannel board. Come on, somebody. Come on back in time. Remember the flannel board? They just put flannel up there and paper people, and they would stick up there and float. And we were like, ooh, that was like high tech. We went to church back in the day. There wasn't no kids' church. You sat in church with your mama. And man, you guys got these nice cushioned seats. We had them old hard wooden pews, man. In church, we go 19 hours. It would go forever, man. And you sat with your mom, and then they'd have a church service, and people start getting the Holy Ghost. And if you didn't have the Holy Ghost, guess what? There'd be a group of people that come get you and drag you down to the front till you got the Holy Ghost. That's the way I grew up. I grew up, there was no options. You went to church. I grew up with my mom and dad's. My dad believed the first day of every week belonged to God. The first dime of every dollar belonged to God. Any otherwise would have been grand theft. That's the way I grew up. Let me ask you this. How many of you had praying parents growing up? Raise your hand nice and high. Okay, I had praying parents. You say, well, me too. Yeah, but they didn't pray like my mom and dad. My dad prayed every morning, God, touch Michael. God, touch Michael. I didn't even need an alarm clock. I woke up every morning listening to my dad pray. My dad prayed prayers of petition. He prayed prayers of intercession. He'd even pray prayers of information. He'd inform God of things I didn't want God to know about. He'd inform God of the fights that I was having with my sister and the grades that I was getting to school. He would inform God of the girls that I was dating. I was like, don't bother God with such trivia. He gave God classified information. But I thank God for a mom and dad that taught me how to pray. My dad prayed every single morning, every single night. We prayed for, I'm telling you, for the food. Even at Thanksgiving when the turkey was getting cold and that gravy was getting that little skin up on top, you know, you had to bust through with a spoon. I'm like, get on with it, Dad. When we get in a car to go somewhere, right? My dad had to lay hands on the airbags. He had to lay hands on the brake pads. Oh, Lord, right now. Put a hedge of protection around our car. I didn't even know what that was. I was 9 years old. I'm like, what's a hedge of protection? Why are you praying for bushes around our car? I was like, is that the devil's weakness? Oh, landscaping, they know. You know, like, If you're going to pray for something, how about some armor around the car or something like that? Forget about bushes. But he would say a hedge of protection. And so that's the way I grew up. Now, I don't know about you, but growing up, how many of you had a curfew growing up? Raise your hand nice and high. A lot of you had a curfew, okay? Mine was midnight. That's just the way that it was. There was no option. Midnight was my curfew. But guess what? When I graduated, went off to Bible college, when I came home, guess what my curfew was? Midnight. It wasn't any different. I remember I came home for Thanksgiving break. Man, I had some of my friends over. It was about 10 o'clock at night. We're all having a good time. All of a sudden, we're about to scoot out of the house. My dad looks over and goes, whoa, 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 where are you going? I was like, well, we're going out. He said, well, you know what time to be back. And I was like, well, I'm in college now. He's like, so? I'm like, I'm in college. He goes, so? I said, man, I'm an adult. I'm in college. And he said, so? And he said, you can say it with me. He said, as long as you live in my house, as long as you live under my roof, you will obey. That's the way it was. How many of you, when you were like little, had a bedtime when you were little? I had a bedtime. My bedtime was 9:30. I thought that was the dumbest bedtime on the planet. One Friday night, I had a friend over. One of my best friends lived next door to me. His name was AJ. And AJ and I were downstairs, and we were playing the Atari 2600. Come on, somebody. Come on, somebody. Come on back in time. I didn't have Xbox and PS4. I didn't have all that stuff. My son's got the controller and the red and the yellow and the green buttons and the triggers, and he's playing online with somebody over in Africa or something like that. We didn't have none of that. We had a joystick and a red button. Come on, somebody. I'm talking about Centipede and Dig Dug and Donkey Kong and Pac-Man, you know, the classics. So we were playing the Atari 2600. It's Friday night. It's 9:30. My dad comes in and says, son, it's time to go to bed. Put that up. Now, when my dad said it was time to go to bed, you didn't say, Pops, we'll be there in a second. You didn't say, well, as soon as we finish this game. Because my dad would go, boy, I'll kill you and make another one just like you. So you never lipped my dad. So we put it up. And we went up in my room. But here's the deal. It's Friday night, okay? I got a friend over. It's 9:30, okay? It's not even dark outside. I'm just being real. How many of you know when it's Friday night and you got a friend over and you ain't even got school the next day, you ain't going to bed at 9:30? So we got in my room and, you know, we were doing this, you know. We were just, you know, just doing stupid things that kids do. And all of a sudden we're punching each other and just wrestling around. And we got up on my bed and we literally started jumping on my bed, right? We're jumping up and down on the bed. And we realized, kind of like on a trampoline, if you hit it just right, it would catapult the other one up higher, okay? So we were trying to smack our heads on my ceiling, you know, because I had that old school acoustic ceiling, you know, with the little flecks of styrofoam. So we're literally trying to smack our heads on the ceiling. And I guess we made too much noise. And my dad busts in the room and goes, hey. And my friend goes, oh, and falls over and dies. It was amazing. He didn't die. But he did flip out. My dad goes, hey. And he goes, oh. My dad goes, what are you doing? Don't parents ask the stupidest questions sometimes? What do you mean, what are we doing? We're jumping down up and down on the bed, and this is awesome. And my dad goes, Michael, don't do that anymore. And I'll tell you, New Life, for years and years and years, I never jumped on my bed anymore. You're like, what's the moral of this story? The moral of the story is if it's Friday night and you got a friend over, and you're, I'm just, if you can't jump on the bed when you're 9, then when can you? I mean, do you jump on the bed when you're 30? Don't answer that. I'm just saying, do you jump on the bed when you're 50? I mean, are you 90? Come on, mama, get on the bed. I mean, who does that? I think 9 years old's prime bed jumping time. There's a story in the Word of God that is very familiar to this story that I just told you. And you're like, where's that found? But it's right there. Jesus is walking and talking with the disciples, and he is just teaching them and pouring into them. And how many of you know the disciples are getting to walk and talk and hang out with Jesus? How many know that's a pretty cool hang? You're getting to hang out with the Son of God. And so the disciples are just enjoying the freedom and the joy and the victory that comes from serving Jesus. And so they're just loving life and they're following Jesus wherever he goes. And they're hanging out with the Son of God and it's awesome. And in the story, you know, it's the Sabbath day. And one of the disciples reaches down and grabs some wheat and starts munching on it. You know the story. And there's some Pharisees standing by. They saw the disciple grab that wheat on the Sabbath, and the Pharisees said to the disciples what my dad said to me and my friend. He said, hey, what are you doing? Here it is. Church, if you can't enjoy the Christian life, if you can't enjoy serving Jesus, if you can't enjoy the liberty and the astonishment and the freedom that comes from serving Jesus, that every now and then you don't want to just jump up and down on your bed or grab some wheat and eat it or whatever, then I don't understand Christianity. Either Christianity and this life that we're all living is the most amazing, wild way of living, or it's a fluke and I'm not interested. I want a Christianity that legitimizes my jumping on the bed. I want a Christianity that legitimizes my grabbing the wheat and eating it or whatever. Because can I tell you that serving Jesus is happiness and freedom and victory and outrageous joy? If you believe it, say yes. Come on, give him praise in this room. That's what serving the Christian, that's what living the Christian life is all about. I'm tired of dead Christianity. I'm tired of dead, dried up, boring churches. I'm tired of this religious spirit that gets in churches and makes us all look like rigor mortis is setting up in our faces. I think people ought to look at your life and see something attractive about Jesus. Amen? I think people ought to come here to New Life and say, man, there's some freedom in that room. Man, there's some liberty in that church. Those people are amazed. I think that's what serving Jesus should be all about. So just right now, touch somebody on their shoulder. Right now, sit next to you. Just touch them and just begin to tremble and pray for them and say, God. No, come on, you got to pray evangelist. I'll say, God, help this person right now. To this morning, think outside the box. Now go, whoa. Did you feel that? You know what? I'm serious. I joke a little bit, but I want some of you to look at Jesus today differently. I want some of you today to look at this church differently. I want some of you to look at your walk with the Lord in a different way than you ever have before, because I believe serving Jesus is happiness and freedom and victory. He said in John 10:10, I've come that you might have life and have life what? More abundantly. God says you want happiness, you want joy, you want victory. I've come that you might have life and you can have an abundant life. That's what the Christian life is all about. But I want to talk about today just a few things that I think are going to open some of your eyes about Jesus and about our faith and about... Let me just say this, and I mean this in all sincerity. How many of you have ever been to church and felt like the little kid in the classroom that didn't know the answer to the question? Let's just be honest today. You ever been there? You ever been in church and you just... Everybody else seemed to be getting it, but you didn't get it. Everybody else was participating, and you're like, okay, I'll just fake it. I don't know what's going on, though. Have you ever been there? See, in school, I didn't learn my multiplication tables as fast as everybody else. I just didn't. It just didn't click with me as much as it did everybody else. And the teacher would get up there, and she'd have the chalk, and she'd go, pow, 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 pow. Everybody got it? Everybody would go, yeah. And I was like, I don't got it. Let's run it back. Ever been in church and felt like that? Ever been in church and a pastor's up there going, well, hallelujah, I want y'all to know the emancipation of the proclamation of the revelation is that Jesus came and there was a dragon. It had seven heads, had seven crowns. There's 144,000 that washed the robes in the blood of the lamb. There's the candlesticks. There's the table of shewbread. Everybody's like, praise the Lord. And you're like, I don't get it. You know, I think our churches ought to be places where people like that are welcome. I think New Life ought to be a place where people can come in and they don't have all the answers and they don't have life all figured out, but they could come in here and see Jesus in you and I and recognize him for who he really is. I'm telling you, man. So I'm going to give you a few myths. Everybody shout myth number one. Here's myth number one, that Jesus is the great leveler, okay? In other words, that Jesus is the great tamer of people. All right, now I don't know about you, but I was taught growing up in church that when Jesus comes into your life, he calms you down. That he makes you tame. You know, that he rids us of all of our differences. Now we're all brothers and sisters in Christ. And now we all know how to talk with that God language. Remember, I talked about it a few moments ago. You're like, what are you talking about? You know exactly what I'm talking about. There's a lingo that we use in church, and nobody out in the secular world has any idea what the heck you're talking about. In other words, here's one. I'm sanctified, okay? That's churchy lingo, okay? You can't go to Giant Eagle and go, what's up? I'm sanctified, okay? They don't even get that. Here's another one. I'm on fire for God, okay? That is such an AG thing. I'm on fire, okay? Don't go to Walmart and go, what's up? I'm on fire. Huh? Come to New Life. We're on fire for God. What are you talking about? You just need to come. We're having a comedy night tomorrow night. We're on fire. They don't get that. Here's my personal, wow. Watch that step. Here's my personal favorite, Pastor Micah. Come to our church where you can be washed in the blood. Yes, come to our church and we'll wash you in the blood. You're going to flip somebody out. They're going to go, don't go to that New Life over there in Altoona. They're a cult. They bathe people in blood. I heard them. They literally are bathing people in blood. See, we all know that over 2,000 years ago, Jesus died on the cross. His blood is still available today to wash away our sins. Amen? But see, unchurched people don't get all that. And we begin to believe that when Jesus comes into our life, that we have to talk like everybody else. We have to sound like a Christian. We have to say amen and praise the Lord and hallelujah. And we can't be wild anymore. We can't be crazy anymore. Have you ever seen somebody in church say, hey, you see that guy over there? Man, when he was unsaved, boy, he used to be wild. But now he loves Jesus. See that girl over there? Boy, she used to be crazy, but now she loves the Lord. Like when you get saved, you can't be crazy anymore. Like when you love Jesus, you can't be wild anymore. I want to tell you guys something. When I lived out in the world, I was crazy. I'm still crazy. But now I just use that craziness in a way that glorifies him. Amen? God made you the way that you are. You don't have to be some cookie-cutter Christian that looks like everybody else and sounds like everybody else. God is doing a new thing today, and I'm telling you that there are things that God is doing, and he's using people just like us, just the way that you are, to point people to him. Amen? You don't have to calm down all the time. See, we begin to believe now we're Christians. Now when we're out in the back doing an errand and we're hammering a nail and we miss the nail and hit our finger like bing, bing, oh, praise the Lord. I don't know about you, but praise the Lord's not what I say. When I hit my finger with a hammer, I'll just turn around and talk to myself. I guess I'm the only carnal person in the building. You're all saved. Shoot. We begin to believe that Jesus molds us and makes us all the same. I want to tell you something. Jesus didn't die on the cross to make us all clones. If Jesus is really who he said he is, and if the church is really the church, may I remind you that New Life is made up of wild, weird, strange, unique, odd people, and we all come together, and Jesus Christ is the common denominator. Amen? I love when I preach a service, and Pastor Wayne, it happens all the time. People come to me afterwards and go, Brother Michael, that was so wonderful. Brother Michael, that was so wonderful. That was so wonderful. That was so wonderful. I just think that's funny. I didn't come for all of you to agree with everything that I said, okay? Seriously, to me, the perfect scenario is not for you to be all morning, amen, 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 amen. No, man, for me, the perfect scenario is, amen, Brother Michael. Amen. Hey, I'm going to look at my word. I'm going to see about that right now. We're going to see about that right now. See, I just tricked you. I just tricked you into reading your Bible. I just tricked you into stretching your faith. We launched a church in Dallas, Texas, 8 weeks ago. I'm not even trying to build a church. I'm trying to build a trap. I'm trying to trap people into looking at Jesus differently. I'm trying to trap people at looking at their faith differently. If you agree with everything that I say, why should I be here? One of us is unnecessary. Right? I came today to challenge somebody. I came to tick somebody off. I have a tick-off anointing. If I'm not ticking a couple of people off every week, I'm upset with myself. But I'm telling you, I want to make a statement. Whatever your strangeness, whatever your uniqueness, whatever your oddness, Jesus Christ meets you there. He doesn't mold you into something that you're not. He starts with that. He doesn't start with that and over time mold you into the godly individual he's always destined you to be. No. Does he refocus you? Yeah. Does he redirect you a little bit? Perhaps. But he doesn't keep you from being you. Amen? He doesn't morph you into something you're not. And I want to tell you something. We live in a culture that intimidates us. You want to know how you can tell Altoona has no Jesus? It's not the bars. It's not the adult bookstores. It's not meth or pornography. You know what it is? It's intimidation. We live in a culture that intimidates us. Friends, look at the internet. Look at magazines. Look at the television. Everywhere you look, drive this and you'll be successful. Wear these clothes. Do this. Do that. Have this cologne and you'll have sex appeal. Have this jewelry. And everywhere in our world, we intimidate people. And dare I say we do it in the church? You ever go to a church and a pastor's up there saying, well, you need to fix this, do this, get rid of this, get rid of this, get rid of this, fix this, tweak this. And when you do all those things, then you'll start looking like a Christian. Then you've got unsaved people walking out going, okay, wow, I feel a whole lot better now. Because they've just been told 20 things that they aren't doing right. Can I tell you, Jesus came to unintimidate you. Jesus came to tell you, I love you like you are. Not when you're all fixed up and nice and religious. I love you. I created you. And me and you against the world are a majority. Can you give him praise in this building if you believe that? You and Jesus are a majority. Man, I'm telling you, we think that we have to be a certain way. Do you remember the Bible story of Jacob? I remember because it's right here in my notes. The Bible says that Jacob and Esau were twins. But I want all of you to know that Esau came out first. Now, I know some of you later are like, no, they were twins. That's true. But Esau came out first. You later are like, they were twins. Esau came out first. They can't come out together. Hallelujah. And all the ladies said amen. One's hard enough. We don't need a double. So you can sit there and argue with me all morning long. They were twins. They were twins. But Esau came out first. And did you know in Old Testament days, whoever came out first was the firstborn? They got the perks. They got the birthright. They got all the goodies. Now, I don't know if some of you are a firstborn, and I know many of you have a firstborn. But let's just be real, friends. How many of you know we put a lot of pressure on that first child? A lot of pressure. I know some of you firstborn are like, that's right. I had it rough. Rougher than all my siblings. It's true. We put a lot of pressure on the first child. And so anyway, I'll tell you, when my son, Chase, was born, my firstborn, I'll tell you guys, I was crazy. I mean, I was reading books, and I was on the internet, and I had it all, man. I had it. Everything had to be just right. I bought Purell. I sanitized. I sterilized. I had the little duck with the thermometer, put it in the bathwater so it wasn't too hot. I had the thing and the handle, you know, with the donut where his head wouldn't fall over, and people would come up, oh, look, and I'm like, get back. Get back. I don't want anybody putting their dirty hands in my baby's face. I mean, food would fall on the ground. I would put it in, sterilize, sanitize everything, man. Man, when my daughter came around, please. Food would fall on the ground. I'd kick it over. Here, Camry, take that right there. Here, just, it's fine. Blow on it. It'll be fine. 3-second rule. People that have the first child, they're like, ooh. Have you ever seen people that have, like, 9 kids? Do you think that the 9th kid is treated like the first kid? You are out of your mind. You go over to somebody's house that has like 12 kids. They usually don't even have clothes on. They're just running around rubbing mud on them. Oh, they're like, yeah, they'll be fine. We went to Picayune, Mississippi. The pastor has 14 boys. 14 boys. Do you think that the first or the 14th delivery was as bad as the first one? Are you crazy? The 14th kid probably just stepped out. Ta-da! Probably drove home. Umbilical cord dragging down the road. Who cares? My son was 9 months old, and he was almost walking. That's pretty good, I thought. He had that little play, little Tyke shopping cart, Pastor. He would do that. You know, he'd push that, and he would, you know, or he'd get on a coffee table, and he'd pull up and do that. You know, he was 9 months old. He was almost walking. He was, like, right there. I thought, this kid's a genius. He's 9 months old. He's already almost walking. 9 months old. I thought, that's pretty good. My neighbor next door had this little seven-month-old Einstein Bobby Fischer kid who was walking around like this at 7 months old, just walking around like that. And I was looking at my son. I was like, you walk. You walk. Neighbor's kid's already walking. You walk. Have you seen people that have 10 kids? The 10 kid comes walking in. Dad's reading the newspaper. He's like, hey, you're walking. Dad, I'm 14. Oh. And I could see why that would be true. So put pressure on the first kid. So the Bible says that Esau came out first. And the Bible says, I don't want to get too crass here, but the Bible says that Jacob reaches out, grabs his brother's ankle, and tries to yank him back inside so he can get out first. Is that freaky deaky or what? Can you imagine you women in the stirrups, and a hand goes, and everybody's like, ah, it's crazy. It's like alien or something. And people say, how do you think that happened, Brother Rowan? How do you think that happened? And also, some knucklehead comes up to me. I'll tell you how it happened. She probably watched too much MTV while she was carrying those boys. She probably smoked weed. It was none of that. That's the way Jacob was when he was born. When Jacob was born, he was a conniver. He wasn't even out of the womb. And he was trying to yank his brother back in to get the upper hand. He was a conniver and a sneaky swindler. And guess what? When Jacob grew up and became a man and met God, guess what? He never changed his personality. He was still sly. He was still sneaky. He was still a conniver. He was still always trying to cut a deal for crying out loud. He wrestled an angel all night long and said, I'm not going to let you go until you bless me. How many are glad your personality is not erased by Jesus? Come on, somebody. You can be who you are. I have no time for Christianity if I can't be different and follow him. I'm different. I just am. I wear different jackets. I wear different glasses. I'm flashy. That's me. I love getting on a plane. It never fails. It happened yesterday. Pastor could tell you. I had on rhinestone tennis shoes. Solid rhinestone tennis shoes with black spikes sticking out of them. And all my tattoos were showing. And I had on a little trilby hat. And I had on all this jewelry. And I had these ripped up jeans on. And I love getting on a plane. It happens every time. How you doing? Doing good. Oh, business or pleasure? I said, well, I'm headed to Altoona. Oh, really? For what? I'm speaking at a church there. Oh, really? What do you do? I'm a pastor. Oh, my goodness! You're what? I'm a minister. Oh! You don't look like a preacher. And I said, really? What do they look like? And they go, oh, well, you know. I'm like, what am I supposed to have on a collar? Am I supposed to have on a robe? Should I have a big wooden cross? Should I have the thing with the chains and the smoke coming out and I just swing it down the aisle? Bless you and you and you. The thing is, God created me like he created me, amen? And he created you like he created you. And you don't have to calm down to serve Jesus. You can be a crazy Christian. You can be an astonished Christian. You can be an alive Christian. You know why? Because alive Christians make dead Christians nervous. Excited Christians make boring Christians uncomfortable. I hope this week y'all make somebody uncomfortable. I hope when they come to church, they're like, my goodness, those people are nuts. Yes, we are. Because how many know all you got to do is remember where you were and where God has brought you from? All you got to remember is I was once lost, but now I'm found. Hallelujah. Someone say myth number two. Myth number two is that all Christians grow the same. Okay. I was taught growing up in church all my life, basically, we're all down here, but the goal is to get up here. Okay. I'm a little fuzzy on this one. Someone's going to have to help me out. In other words, down here, we're all rotten, filthy sinners. But up here, we're on fire, sanctified, washed in the blood. Well, how do we get from here to here? I'm a little fuzzy on this. And again, every time I say, how do we get from here to here? I always have some believer come up. I'll tell you, Brother Rowan, we get from here to here by praying. We get from here to here by going to church. We get from here to here by reading our Bibles. And all that's true. But how many of you know that ain't all? Because growing is about suffering. Growing is about pain. Growing is about burnout. Growing is about going through some of the most difficult moments in life because God will teach you something. How many of you know you learn through pain? I feel like preaching now. How many have a degree from the School of Hard Knocks? Say it with me. You learn through pain. You learn through pain, man. There's something going on right now in America that has astounded me. It's the dumbest thing I've ever seen. I want to talk to you about it because I think it's just really dumb. I'm not saying I'm an authority or anything. I'm just saying, you know, when you die and go to heaven, you'll see that I was right. It's called timeout. If you don't know what timeout is, it's when your kid is acting like an idiot and you put them in timeout. This is so dumb. Let me tell you why. Because I will bust my kid's backside. Can I get a hallelujah? Come on, somebody. Spare the rod. Come on. How many remember a little thing called a switch growing up? Remember one of those? That's when your parents would take a branch and beat your backside. My mom and dad would let me go pick out my own switch. They said, go get a switch. I'd come in with a little twig and go, I'm so sorry, I'm so sorry. My dad would go, nope, that's not a switch. He'd go out and get Pastor Wayne some big, long, green thing and come in. It was like, psh, and I'd be like, psh, psh. And it was during these beatings that I would have an epiphany. He'd be like, pow, pow, ooh, I think. I will never do that again. Because, I mean, you learn through pain. You're like, well, you better watch it. CPS, shut up. I'll beat their kids. I'll beat your kid. I'll beat you. I'll beat anybody's kid. If I'm in a Walmart, some kid's like, I'll be like, yeah, got one just like it. Here you go. Take that back. No charge. Someone's like, your kids can divorce you. I'd like to see my kid divorce me. I'm telling you, I had a paddle in my house, and it had timeout written on it. That was time out in my house. I tattooed time on one butt cheek and out on the other. Bam! Serious. You learn through pain. Man, I remember one time, my mom's short. My mom is really, really tiny short. When I was about 14, I shot up real tall. My mom was all short. She was always getting on me. I'm telling you right now. You're about to pick yourself up off the floor. And she'd always say, so one day I was all like, just doing something. She's like, she's like, your father. And I went, well, he ain't here, is he? My mom went, and punched me in the face. She punched me in the face and bloodied my nose. And then she said those horrible words, you can say them with me, you wait till your dad gets home. Oh, my goodness. I was like, I heard the car pull up, and I was like, oh, my God. I was freaking out. If my dad would have come in and said, Michael, come here, and I'd have come down there, and he'd have said, your mom says you've been acting like a fool. Yes, sir. You get up in your room right now. for 15 minutes. And you be quiet, because you're in timeout. I'd have been like, got away with it, right? I was at a church one time, and this lady's little demon, I mean her son, she's trying to talk to me after the service. And he's all like, and she's freaking out. And I'm sitting there going, and he's like pulling on her dress. She's crying. She's trying to talk to me. And he's all like, just freaking out. And I'm sitting there. And she's like, Timmy, stop it. Timmy, stop it. He's like, he's just freaking out. And I was just sitting there thinking, give me 5 minutes. 5 minutes with that kid. He's all, and I was like, you're so cute. I'll kill you. I'll kill you. You learn through pain. Where are you at? Will you come and help me? I'm getting ready to close. I'm not closing, but I'm getting ready to point in the direction that eventually in a moment, in a few, I will close. I'm teasing. How many of you give me one more minute? Just one. 1 minute, please. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. Okay. You learn through pain. You learn through difficulty. You learn through struggle. How many of you know we grow by reading our Bible, we grow by going to church, we grow by praying, but more times than not, you will grow through the most difficult situations of your life. Give me a little bit more mic. I promise I won't scream. I won't promise, but give me a little bit more. So I was in Colorado, and a friend of mine who's an evangelist, he's just like me, travels full-time, love offering basis. At the end of the service today, Pastor will give you guys a chance to bless us. That's how his ministry ran. And I was in Colorado, and we were skiing, just me and some friends. He wasn't with us. Now, catch the picture. We're just up on a mountain. Snow's blowing around. I got the gloves on. We're sliding around stuff. And my phone rings. So I take my teeth, and I pull my gloves off, and I grab my phone. I go, hello? He said, Michael. That's all he said. He didn't even say another word. I just said, hello, Michael. And immediately I said, what? He said, man, I have cancer. I said, oh, man. I said, what do you mean? He said, I have testicular cancer. I said, well, you know what? Radiation and chemotherapy. And he said, no, man, just listen to me for a second. I said, no, man, I'm not going to listen to you because, you know, there's doctor, you know, there's stuff. And man, we'll get you a juicer, and we, you know, just, he said, Michael, listen to me. I said, no, I'm not going to. He said, Michael. I said, what? He said, man, it's moved up to my lymph nodes. They said, I only have 10 months to live. I want you to do my funeral. I said, man, don't say that to me, please. Then his daughter got an incurable disease. The disease name is so long, I can't even. Then his wife of 16 years said goodbye. She literally came into the room and said, I don't love you. I've never loved you. She said, I was faking it the whole time. She said, I had feelings for you like the first year, but other than that, I really don't. And so she said, I'm out. There was no infidelity, no adultery, no misconduct of it. She just said, I don't want it. I don't want this. I don't need it. I don't want to be married to you. You're a great dad. You're a good husband. I just don't need it. And she left. So you have a partner for, you think, the rest of your life, and she just says goodbye. Then your daughter has an incurable disease. She's still not right to this day. She has to go to the doctor every week. And then you're told you have 10 months, and then you're going to die. How many of you know sometimes just saying to somebody, well, you know what? The Lord's the great. Yeah, that just doesn't get it. Can I just be real? This is real this morning. Give those pat little answers we give people. Well, I'm going to keep you in my prayers. God's so faithful. You know what? He's going to come through. Sometimes that just doesn't get it. And so he got sick, and he had to cancel all his meetings. So I was calling churches up on the phone saying, hey, could you take a love offering for Ronald? Hey, could you do this? Could you do this? I was literally trying to, and then I went to see him. Have you ever seen something and, like, you hope that your face doesn't show what you see? He opened the door, and there were X's all over his body where they had zeroed in for stuff, and he was like skin and bones. It was like a sheet of skin on bones,
He couldn't eat. And I would mix up ice chips, and he'd vomit them. I couldn't even hold down ice. He would throw up bile, and I would take a sponge, and I would wipe his back off, and I would hold the trash can. Now, you got to understand, when I first started ministry 24 years ago, Pastor Wayne, people coming up to me all the time saying, I'd say, is anybody ever, you know, Bible study or something? Anybody ever in prayer requests? So-and-so has cancer. Yep, we're going to pray for that. So-and-so, my mom has a lump in her breast. They're saying it's a tumor. Da-da. You know what? God's a great physician. We're going to pray for that. Hey, so-and-so's got chemo, and they're really struggling. You know what? We're just going to believe God. And I was just kind of skipping along. Please understand, I wasn't trying to be a jerk. I was just taking prayer requests. But you see, it had never impacted me the way that did. Because I walked through that with my friend, and I wiped it, and I held the trash can when he threw up, and I visited him. So now when someone comes to me and says, Pastor, my mom has cancer, they don't have to say another word. They don't have to say another word. You know why? Because they know I already know. And that kind of knowing comes through suffering. And that kind of growth and knowledge comes through painful moments. Because I walked through that with my friend, who is, by the way, now cancer-free. God healed him. He has no cancer in his body. So does Jesus just calm you down all the time? No. Do we all grow the same? No. Some of you read your Bible every day. Some of you don't. Some of you pray for an hour. Some of you, if you pray for 10 minutes, you're like, yes. We're all at different places in our growth journey, and that's okay. But in closing this morning, honestly, the last thing, and really don't have time, but I'll just throw it out there. I just call it astonishment versus boredom. Do you want to know why some churches aren't astonished? Do you want to know why some churches are bored? Because they're not astonished anymore. Do you want to know why some preachers are bored with their own messages before they even preach them? Because they're not astonished anymore. But can I tell you that the glory of the gospel is that you and I could recognize that when Jesus Christ came, he came to save me just as I am. And that blows me away. That God would love me. Some of you will hear my testimony at the comedy night tomorrow night. And when you hear my testimony, you'll think, and you travel in the world preaching now? That's a miracle. Yeah. It blows me away. Can I tell you, man? Jesus is different. If I were jumping on the bed and all of a sudden Jesus walked in the room and went, hey, I think it would be different than when my dad came in. I think it would be different. It would. Of course, the whole room would fill with light because his head would be glowing. But other than that, I don't think he would say, hey, what are you doing? I think Jesus would go, hey, you got some room for me on that bed? Come on, somebody. He'd say, hey, me and you can jump together. That's the kind of Jesus that I serve. Are you still astonished? Are you going to be blown away at what God does tonight? Stephanie is going to, Lord willing, share her personal testimony. There won't be a dry eye in this building. We're going to give a good old-fashioned Holy Ghost Pentecostal altar call tonight. How many still believe in altar calls? Amen? Tired of these churches now. All they want to do is put up coffee shops and talk about 10 ways to have a victorious life and blah, blah, blah. And they don't ever talk about Jesus anymore. They don't talk about heaven and hell anymore. They don't ever talk about it's motivational speaking. I still believe in an old-fashioned Holy Ghost Pentecostal altar call. I still believe you can come down here and God transform your life. I'm just a little old-fashioned. But you got to be astonished. I believe that when we come into church, we ought to say, Lord, I can't believe it. And if you can't come into New Life every week and go, God, I can't believe it, then you've lost it. You've lost it. We've become so predictable in church.
Well, we're going to come in today and we're going to sing three fast and two slow. That's what we do. We're going to come in, so we're going to sing three fast, two slow. We're going to have the offering, a little prelim, a couple of announcements, and the preaching of the word.
I pray God messes y'all up this week. I pray that God so jacks up your whole plan. I pray that it just turns you. We should just come in, I preach, and you sing at the end. That would just mess some of y'all up when you'd be like, wait.
It doesn't do, we don't do it that way.
Who said, where's the big book that we have to sing three fast and two slow? What if we sing one slow and then we just preach? What if we sang at the end? What if we didn't sing at all? What if we just came in here and lay down on the ground and said, Lord, come and meet us right now in this place. Lord, just come. Let your glory fill up this place. Why not? We become so predictable. I have 2 minutes. I just share this story and I'm done. There was a man named David Cartledge. He wrote a book called The Apostolic Revolution that is phenomenal. He was the president of Southern Cross College. Every year we would go to Hawaii to put on a family conference together. We always had to suffer for Jesus in Hawaii. And he told me the story. He's dead. He went on to be with Jesus. But the last year of his life, he told me a story, Pastor, of a little church, about 50 people he was preaching in. And he's thundering away up there preaching. All of a sudden, there was a clatter of chairs in the back, like literally a clatter of chairs. And they looked back, and a woman fell out under the power of the Holy Ghost. Literally, she fell out. She was trembling and laughing and shaking and speaking in tongues and just lost in the presence of God. He said it went on for like 5 or 10 minutes. He said, I didn't even know what to do. It was almost a distraction. He said, I just kept preaching. He said, and at the end of the service, they went over there, and she's just still there, cackling and laughing and shouting and speaking in tongues and crying and laughing and just in another place. He said, we waited an hour, and she never came back to where we were. He says, so we left her there. He said, we went and ate lunch. We came back. She was still there. He said, we came back for service that night. She was still there. He said, she'd been laying there like 7 hours. Just shaking and trembling and laughing and shouting. And he said, we started the service, and about midway through the service, she finally came around. He said, after the service, she came up to the pastor and my friend David and said, Pastor, do you want to know what happened to me today? She said, this morning I was born again. She said, this morning I saw him. She said, this morning for the first time in my life, the scales were taken off my eyes, and I saw him, and I fell in love with him, and I saw him for who he really was. Now, here's the kicker. This woman was not a sinner. She was the associate pastor's wife. She wasn't some person off the street that had ever been in church. She was a pastor's wife, and yet she said, I was born again. For the first time in my life, I saw him. She called her dad to tell her dad what had happened. You know what he said? Don't be stupid. He said, you've been a Christian all your life. How many of you know religion can blind you from the truth? And so, no altar call today. You say, well, wait a minute, this is Sunday morning. This is what we do. I don't do what we think is supposed to be done. I'm tired of structured religion. I'm tired of people that are half in, half out, apathetic, lukewarm, complacent believers that come in. We have the most incredible gospel in the world. There's people that can't even read pages of the Bible in other countries. They have to meet in little underground huts. And we can come here and worship God in freedom, and we take it for granted. And so I wanted to preach this message to you today that I didn't even get to finish. But I want to preach it because I want to set the tone for tonight, tomorrow night, and Tuesday night. I'm not going to bring the worship team back up right now. We sing a bunch of songs. I'm not going to clap my hands. I'm not going to snap my fingers. We're not going to play these games. I'm not going to bring down the altar workers or the prayer team and say, come on down. I'm not going to say, tap the person next to you. We're not going to do that stuff. I came this morning on an assignment to talk to New Life Worship Center in Altoona, Pennsylvania, and tell you, if you've been just coming to church and it's just not been the same that it used to be. If you've been coming to church and you've just been going through the motions and you've just been going through the routine, I'm telling you, Jesus is the joy and the victory and the freedom and the passion and the excitement. That's what serving God is. You don't have to calm down. We all grow at different lengths, but if you get anything that I said today, be astonished. Be blown away. But the bottom line is, you used to come to church when you first got saved saying, I wonder what Pastor Wayne is going to say to us. That's what they used to say. What is he going to say to us? Now you come in and go, I hope he has something to say. There's a big difference. So will you promise me that for the next three nights in a row at 6:30, you will come in expecting a move of God? Come on, raise your hand if that's you. Without expectation, there is no impartation. You get what you expect. People used to ask me all the time at Brownsville, how did that happen? Father's Day, 1995. Oh, my goodness, 9 million people, 500,000 documented salvations. Oh, my goodness, Pastor Mike, what was that like to see 5,000 people six nights a week for 5 years? What was it like to see people stand in line 17 hours to get into church? What was it like to start church at 7 and go to midnight and start seeing people get in the parking lot at 3 o'clock in the morning for the following night's service? Pastor Michael, what was that like to see the power of God so strong that custodians couldn't even go in and clean? Can I tell you, more than a few times, I'd walk into sanctuary and see 3 custodians laid out speaking in tongues with a running vacuum cleaner. Looked like a drive-by shooting or something. It was crazy. So for the next three nights at 6:30, will you say, I'm going to come in and say, God, astonish me. Blow me away. I'm not going to buy into the myths of Christianity any longer. Lord, blow me away. If you want to do that, give the Lord the greatest clap offering you can give him right now. Come on. Come on, clap your hands, all ye people. Shout unto God with a voice of triumph. Would you put your hands out like this? May the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious unto you. May the Lord lift his countenance upon you and give you peace. May he cover you with his name, the name of Jesus. Father, for every person in this room, bless their families, bless their homes, bless their marriages, bless their children, bless their finances, bless their jobs, their relationships, bless their physical health. Lord, in every way, for every outstretched hand, bless them with favor unlike they've ever known. In Jesus' name, all God's people said, amen. In just a moment, Pastor's going to come. He's going to give you an opportunity to bless the ministry. Well, Brother Michael, what do you want to say about that? Are you going to give us a scripture? Are you going to give us a teaching? I'm not going to do any of that. I'm going to say what I told you 2 years ago. We are a faith-based ministry. What does that mean? It's a fancy way to say we don't have a clue what we make. That's true. It's a fancy way. It just sounds better than go, we don't have a clue, ministries. We're a faith-based ministry. When I call Pastor on the phone to reschedule, I never one time said, I have to have this much money. I didn't know if the church had grown, gotten smaller, stayed the same. The first time I came here, didn't know what they ran. I never said to him one time, I got to have first class seats. I need this. I want the best of this. I want all these things. I didn't say, I need a minimum of this. We need a minimum of this many people. I have to have this much money. It's got to be like this. You're like, well, that's silly, man. Ministries don't do that. All friends. Can I love you enough to tell you, there's some ministries that wouldn't even darken the door of Altoona. And I'm not bagging on them. How they run their ministry is their business. But we told the Lord, we will go wherever you open up the doors. We've been doing this for 24 years. All I ask is if the ministry has touched your life, this is an opportunity for you to sow back into us a seed. If I cut open an orange, I can lay out every seed inside that orange. I could show you every one. I could never, ever show you how many oranges are in a seed. It's impossible. So the seed that you sow today ensures that our ministry continues to move on down the road. Can't wait to see you guys tonight. Stephanie's going to be here. She's going to share with you as well. Bring a friend. Let's pack this place out and have a great time. Give the Lord praise one more time.